One.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Lee Olson. I'm the chair of the City of Reading Planning Commission. Welcome to the January 28th edition. We do have a quorum, and we shall get right to our agenda. First item on the agenda is the acceptance of the January 28th Planning Commission agenda. Do I have a motion to accept the agenda as presented?
Make the motion, Mr. Chairman, to accept.
So moved by Ermetti. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second by Wayne. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Okay, thank you very much. Next item on the agenda is a zoning text amendments for Alvernia University. Chapters 600-807, 600-814, 600-1603, and 600-2202. Mr. Loyak is here from the university. John, please come forward and we'll hear your presentation.
Thank you. We have an overhead presentation, but there's also some materials that I can leave with you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
We do have a self-imposed time limit only because we feel we have to, but it's at our discretion, so there's no time limit, so you,
okay.
you can
we'll cut me off and go.
Do your stuff. Do your stuff, no problem.
Great. Is there a way to flip the slide?
Oh.
Just give me a, we can go past it.
And John, if you need a pointer.
Ah, perfect. Great. So, Reading College Town, as you know, many of you probably heard about our announcement that we're working on the acquisition of 401 Penn Street. So 401 Penn Street will become a live, learn environment, and it will house our College of Engineering, Technology, and Business. So you can see some of the programs on the slide that will be there. A big focus on STEM through engineering and technology programs. We are already kicking off a student-centric business incubator. That process is underway, but it will move into the facility downtown. We will do esports and technology programs, and we will have somewhere north of 200 students living there when we fully expand out the housing option. From an economic development perspective, we'll have students living 24/7, many of them 365 days a year because of graduate students living in the downtown. We'll have a lot of opportunity to partner with businesses. I think we're talking about 20 different partnership relationships, and we're not even in the building yet with many people who are interested in partnering with us. We'll bring a national food franchise. We're going through a campus-wide food service RFP, and as part of that, we're asking the food service bidders to bring a franchise to this facility. So that would be, as we'll see in one of the pictures here as we move forward, right on the corner of 4th and Penn. Lots of potential collaborative partnerships. We're working, I think we have 12 active initiatives now with Reading Area Community College to partner in various things as neighbors in the downtown. We're working with the Goggle Works on some art program that would allow our students to utilize their facilities during the day. And that we would jointly develop a program that would bring art-oriented students to the downtown. Those are just a couple of examples. We also have taken all of the history from the Reading Eagle, and that will be made available. All those archives will be made available in the downtown facility for anybody who's doing research or is just curious and interested about the city's history and so on. For us, it's also a mission item. The Sisters started 125 years ago to serve the underserved in downtown Reading. That mission will continue through the expansion of the university into the downtown. I've made this statement publicly before, so I'll make it as part of this presentation. We've done a lot of growth up in the 18th Ward, but you know, we really now are surrounded by the neighborhood. And so as the university continues to grow the footprint we'd like to grow it in, it's not just 401 Penn Street, but in downtown Reading, as we continue to grow out housing and academic facilities even beyond 401 Penn Street, which is really why we put the application in for some of the changes that we did with the setback. So I sort of think of College Town in the triangle. To be in the city and building some of the partnerships and all of that that we would like to build and build the programming and the student housing that we don't have room for on the main campus, we have to have a building. So everything starts with building 401 Penn Street is our hope for it. That's a rendering of what 401 Penn Street might look like when we completely renovate it. But again, the things that would be in there would be our business incubator, our business graduate and undergraduate programs, our communications graduate and undergraduate programs, 5 to 6 new engineering programs that would be developed in that facility, the business incubator. And with that, we'll still have 2 vacant floors, even with 200 students living in the building, that will continue to build programming out in the downtown. At full capacity, that probably represents, again, more than 200 students living there and probably 600 to 700 students taking classes there throughout the academic year and over the summer. And this represents the corner where the food service operation would go and where the National Brand would come in to the downtown, and sort of gives you a little idea of what that could look like. We could flip to the next. Again, we're doing this because we have some academic programs that we can grow. And some of that revolves around refreshing our business program and adding some new business programming to it, like a hospitality major and several others. That's an example of what one of our business labs would look like in the downtown. You'd be able to see all that technology as you're walking down Penn Street. The next slide is where our communications area would be. Again, that would be open, and you would see all the activities of students doing all of their work related to communications and television right there on Penn Street, which we think is a nice addition to Penn Street. We can go to the next. This is the business incubator and what the business incubator will look like. That actually would be on the entrance of the building on the 5th and Penn side. You literally would walk through those turnstiles and that would be the reception area and in to the business incubator. We think we'll have somewhere between 30 and 40 offices available. We will work case files on every idea from inception all the way through to funding and the first wave of operations. Our students will participate in that. We have a network of mentors, a local SCORE chapter, and several other groups that will be teaming up with us in the business incubator to support business ideas. And we're even working on developing the Angel Network to do some early funding for some of these ideas, with the idea that those ideas would stay in downtown Reading. The last part is the student living piece, and we can flip one more. You get an idea of what the student rooms will look like. Again, meant to be very urban apartment style living. You can go to the next one. Gives you some idea of what it would look like. They'll be very light in the way of kitchens. It'll be a microwave and a refrigerator and a sink. We really want the kids out in town. Utilizing the city, there will be upperclassmen or graduate students who have the capacity to do that. The Association for Independent Colleges and Universities will tell you for every student living in the downtown, they spend somewhere between $5,000 and $7,000 a year in that downtown. So you can quickly do the math on the number of students that will be there. It's millions of dollars of commerce for the city. And then last is the community partnerships, and it really becomes the foundation of what we do. As I said, I think we're talking to 20 different parties about programs and relationships that will kick off as we move into the downtown. When I went through this process in downtown Wilkes-Barre, we did 6 different projects. The biggest was buying the Ramada Hotel on Public Square and converting that into academic space and student living, bringing the first Chick-fil-A to Luzerne County. And many other things. It's amazing the things that grow out of the university being in the center of the city. It's not just student activity or faculty activity or programming, which you might expect, but the partnerships and things that come out of it are wonderful. So I'd like to end with this quote from Winston Churchill, which is, we shape our buildings, and we certainly will reshape this building, which, you know, was an insurance company headquarters, and then a charter school, and now a college within a university. But thereafter, all the things that come out of it will shape the community.
Do you want the video?
Yeah, that would be great. And this is just some thoughts from our students about it.
Where did the volume go?
It's okay if we don't run it, but I always think it's great to get a student perspective.
You find it, Adam?
No, where'd it go? Or do we have to go back to the main?
Maybe we'll do that like this. Hold on.
Okay.
Go
that way.
Perfect.
New opportunities, for sure, whether it be education, internships, businesses, whatever the case may be, anything that can contribute back in terms of like what you can do for people.
I'm at Alvernia now, and I still like to come to downtown Reading, so it's still pretty fun to be here. Well, I think Alvernia having a presence in downtown would be awesome. I mean, it can show people, even little kids, that, hey, college can be worth it, and college is able to be obtained.
Yeah, I remember walking downtown, and the university presence was right. It would be great to see Alvernia's presence downtown, just because it would create that college town. Coming from the city, I've been able to see the presence from Alvernia eventually, and it's just a special connection with me and Alvernia, as well as me in the city of Reading. Just having people like them is a blessing.
I want this to be a positive city, so in the next few years, I would like to see Reading not being downplayed as a negative city. I want it to be a beautiful, positive city.
So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions or provide any other information you might all need.
Okay, thank you very much. Adam, we'd like to hear from you, and also David, and if you've got something from community development to add, I'd like to hear that. So, Adam, why don't you take us through the process?
I'm going to change the process on that for you, and I'm going to bring in our zoning administrator, Dave, who's going to go through the list of the zoning codes that are requested in the main group. And then he will give the zoning opinion, and then once we're done, I will then address any comments and suggest changes.
So. All right, so Dave, you've got the floor. Give us your overview and our recommendations, please.
Yeah, I just want to provide a little bit of a context with what the existing zoning ordinance requirements are and how these changes, basically where these changes would fit into the existing ordinance. Starting with the allowed uses in the commercial core, that's the 807B. The proposal would add dormitories or other residential uses owned or operated by a college or university to the list of permitted by right uses. And then it would remove under the list of permitted uses where college or university is currently listed as other than residential uses, it would remove that other than provision. And then under the special exception uses where dormitories are currently listed, it would remove that. So the effect of all of those textual changes would be that dormitories would be listed as a permitted by right use rather than a special exception use. And the big difference in that change is that there would not be a level of review other than the issuance of a zoning permit and whatever land development review might be applicable, as the case may be. With the existing building, that may not trigger land development, whereas creation of a new building potentially would. So this change does not affect how Planning Commission's involvement would be, but it does affect whether or not the Zoning Hearing Board would be involved in the process. And I just wanted to touch on really briefly what the Zoning Hearing Board does as part of that review. They evaluate whether the proposal would have an effect that would increase traffic congestion, create traffic safety hazards, undue concentration of population, whether there would be adequate light and air supply to neighboring properties, any significant threats to health or safety, whether there would be a detriment to the appropriate use of the adjacent property, any nuisances or hazards. Those are all the things that the Zoning Hearing Board is evaluating as part of their review of a special exception. Special exception uses are permitted in a district, They just require that level of zoning hearing board review. They're not like a variance where basically the assumption is this is a not permitted thing. So currently, dormitories are a permitted use, but they require that special exception review. One other piece of context I wanted to provide here is that the Penn Square Overlay District also applies in this area. And there was some discussion as to whether a change would be appropriate in the language in the Penn Square Overlay District. It does include a provision excluding dormitory uses, but that only applies after the first 60 feet back on the ground floor level. So dormitories on the second floor or higher, which I understand to be the proposal here, would not be affected by that provision in the Penn Square Overlay. That area only applies also between 2nd and 6th Street along Penn Street. So there may be other sites that are in the commercial core, but that are not affected by the Penn Square Overlay. And then one other comment I had on this area in here is that there is not a specific provision right now that says that the street level floor for dormitories, where there is a dormitory, that the street level be maintained as a restaurant or office or retail use. And our recommendation would be that if there is any change that is made to the language here, that there be an express provision similar to what we added with adaptive reuse, just to maintain that consistency. And I would even add to make it specific to the types of uses that are consistent with the comprehensive plan, rather than just any commercial use, specify what kind of commercial uses you want. So that's our comment on the first one. Adam, did you want to
just go?
Okay, I'll just go through it first. And then, all right. So then on the parking, the proposal here would be to add a provision to change what is required for dormitories. So currently in the downtown, in the commercial core, colleges and universities do not have a parking requirement except for residential uses, which would include the dormitories. The provision for dormitories is that there has to be one parking space provided for every two beds, unless these students are not allowed to have a vehicle. There's also a general provision that says if a college provides off-site parking, then they can count that as part of their parking. The proposal here would actually change that to say that the parking exception for dormitories would also kick in if the university provides regular transportation service. So if there was a shuttle service, for example, then the parking requirement would simply be eliminated for those dormitory uses. Again, that's the proposal here. Our notes on this is just that some clarity is recommended as part of whatever review would happen. And as we'll discuss, we believe the special exception review is appropriate for these types of proposals. And if so, that would be the venue for a review of whether the shuttle service was adequate to the city's needs. And if there's any particular rules that needed to apply to those shuttle services, that should be spelled out as part of this process. On to the definitions. There's two proposals in here, one to change the definition of a student home and then the other one for a dormitory. As for the student home, there's a recommendation to specifically exclude residential uses that are owned or operated by a college or university within the Penn Square Overlay District. This definition is not a pretty one as it currently stands, and there's actually an exclusion already in the definition that takes care of what's recommended here. The definition already excludes dormitories that are owned and or operated by an institution of higher education. So for our purposes, and I just, again, this context wanted to provide this, that our office would already not consider any of these types of, like a dormitory owned or operated by an institution of higher education is not a student home. So we're already clear on that. Adding the Penn Square Overlay District, in our opinion, doesn't really change anything as to what our interpretation of this already is. As for the definition of a dormitory, there's a comment, and I'm not sure that the specific proposal for a revised definition was with this application, other than there's a note that says removal, any limit of occupancy on the number of occupants per room be removed. We don't currently have a limit on occupancy in the zoning ordinance for dormitory uses, although other occupancy codes would apply, in the building code and so forth, as far as the number of occupants for dormitory rooms. We would recommend in this, as part of this process, just doing a survey of other cities' ordinances for dormitory definitions to come up with something that would be suitable to New Ulm. And then the final section I wanted to make mention of here is 1202E of the zoning ordinance. That was not part of this proposal, but I just wanted you all to be aware that it exists because it contains additional requirements for colleges and universities. It falls under special exception review, so it provides, for example, that you have to submit a detailed plot plan and a complete set of architectural plans, some long-term plan information for, you know, what the occupancy is going to be in the future. And again, I just wanted you to be aware that this provision exists so that if there are any additional requirements tied to any of these uses, we would want to look to see if it would be appropriate to cross-list or cross-reference this section just as part of this review process. But it's just another place to be aware of the zoning ordinance as we look at this.
All right, why don't we, Adam, follow through? Since Dave is finished, let's go to you, please.
Dave and I have had several meetings on this along with other individuals, and I mean, pretty much as of this point, I concur with everything that zoning has recommended. I just want to point out again that staff does not recommend a use by right. We would like to see a level of review continued through special exception. Again, based on what we've already done in the adaptive reuse area, we'd like to see the provision expressly providing for street level areas to be used for retail, office, restaurant, you know, the same commercial restaurant use that we've seen throughout the corridor. One question that we would like answered, if at all possible, is Mr. Loyak, does the university have a requirement requiring students to reside on campus or within campus housing, or is it wherever they would like, unless they're commuters?
Yeah, we do for the first 2 years of your programming.
As for the off-street parking, I'm going to defer the Planning Commission on that, as they have said they've taken parking pretty seriously. Staff recommends a review of the parking shuttle plan, mainly looking at, amongst other things, the amount of parking that they have not only on main campus but here, but also drop-off pickup points, either on Penn Street Court or one of the other streets as well, so that we're not messing with the interfering with the flow of traffic. I concur with zoning on the definition of students' homes, and then of course the dormitory definition, removing the limit of occupancy. Staff can recommend that. We were looking at an occupancy limit set basically on habitable space, either using either unit size or the International Building Code, or as we always do, a review of other cities to see what they do as well. So those are my recommendations to the board. Obviously, I will leave it to your discussion to hash out what you'd like to see moving forward.
Okay, Tammy, anything that you'd like to add to the review of the city from community development?
We don't have enough time to hear what I have to say about this project. I think that this is something that we have prayed for a very long time in this city, and I think that however we can help this project move forward is going to be a positive for the city. We need this relationship. We need these students. We need these business collaborations with Alvernia. And I'm just very excited about this project. I mean, I want to see this happen, and I hope that everybody can work together to make it happen.
Tim, I don't know if you've had much time to look at what's been presented, and I know from a public work standpoint, your work will start later.
I would like to make one comment,
please,
especially the parking. That's my main concern. Yeah, and I agree with Tammy, this is a great idea. But as far as modifying the zoning ordinance, I agree with zoning that something should be done with parking, not just leave it off and just make it up as we go. I think there should be something in the zoning ordinance, and I think the recommendation for dormitories is a good one. If this were a school in any other part of the city, it would not only be the students that drive, it would be the faculty that drives and any other employee too. You'd have to provide parking. So this gives you something to go by. Now, I know this is downtown, so you have other provisions for parking. This used to be Aetna. There was a lot of employees. They parked somewhere. So I think it's good to have something in here, and I thought that was, you know, I concur with the zoning's opinion on that. And then I guess as we get into the actual land development of it, we'll look at specifics as far as commuting. And if I did the math right, we have 200 in the dorms, up to 700 total. That means maybe 500 commuting. Does that sound about right?
Could be.
Okay. So there's a lot of students there that need to park, and parking is near and dear to me because off-street or on-street parking and the provision for off-street parking. Discussions with the Reading Parking Authority will need to happen and to coordinate with them. And I think that, you know, that's something that needs to be seriously discussed.
Yeah, last night at the council meeting, Aaron Gantz did a presentation and expressed that we have 7,000 parking spaces in the city of Reading. Mm-hmm. So I would imagine the parking authority would be happy to discuss with you reserved spaces and passes and stuff like that. I mean, I don't know that they're all available, but that's a lot of parking in the city.
And that's all the 7 garages and the surface lots.
Yeah, she did like an overall city, how much parking we have available for redevelopment.
Okay. All right. Tim, thank you. All right, I'd like
to follow up. That's parking authority spaces?
She didn't say parking authority spaces. Okay. She said 7,000 spaces in the city.
Yeah, I understand.
But I bet you most of them are parking authority.
That would have to be qualified as parking authority.
Yeah, it wouldn't be private spaces.
I doubt it. Okay. I mean, I don't know if any that aren't owned by the authority. It's probably all of them.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Staff, thank you. What I'd like to do is open it up to members of the commission for comments for either Mr. Loyack or any of our staff. Wayne, I'll start with you, sir.
Okay. First, I do think I think there's a request to add a definition for college or university. I see here on the annotations it says college or university would be defined as any college or university accredited by Middle States Commission on Higher Education. Is there another way that a college or university could be accredited? And I only bring this up because I'm not familiar with it, but like, is the accreditation committee or whatever it is that accredits Albright and Avernia, is it the same one that accredits RAC?
I actually don't know how to work for community colleges, so I can't
answer. So yeah,
that.
I think,
but
that's
all,
yeah.
Four-year colleges in the Mid-Atlantic are regulated and accredited by Middle States. But the thought was that, actually I was asked for a definition of what should a college and university be. By definition, you can have unaccredited institutions, oftentimes for-profit, online programs that are housed in cities are not accredited institutions. So to me, the accreditation is what separates a real college and university from something that's not. And so it was the only way I could differentiate college and university. The definition is not near and dear to my heart. So.
Yeah, I'm just asking if I can piggyback on that.
Yeah.
As an engineer in the engineering school, are you considering ABET accreditation?
We certainly are. Yeah. And our business school is accredited.
Do you have a schedule for when you might receive that?
Yeah, so if you know how ABET accreditation works.
Somewhat.
You have to have a facility, faculty, a curriculum that they approve. And then to get the full accreditation, you have to graduate your first student. So that process is generally a four-year process that starts with the first incoming class. And it can actually start a year earlier, and oftentimes we have students who will graduate on a three-year track with this. They'll do academic work over the summer months. So it could happen in 3 years, but the standard track would be 4 years. Yeah. But they would all be ABET accredited good programs.
Thank you.
Okay, so I think I just ask staff to look into that, so we just make sure that we don't, if RAC decides that they need something, that we don't exclude them, because you know they're the first ones to move downtown. They took a building that was what flooded out during Agnes and built it into something. So you know, we don't want to exclude them. That's the only reason
and
I
that's
pointed
that
out.
No.
I think that's a great place to start with that, but I think we might need to do some research on that. Let's see, there was some confusion about. There's some confusion about the transportation service. I would prefer to see the students park as close to downtown as possible. I think we need to check with the parking authority to see how many spaces RAC is actually using at Front and Washington. Because every time I go there, that parking lot's basically empty. I think it would be nice if, you know, we could come to some sort of agreement that certain floors could be used by Alvernia, because Front and Washington really isn't that far from 4th and Penn. And that way, you know, that most of that lot becomes, you know, like for an institutional use. But you know, that's just my idea.
And that garage, I believe, is owned by RAC. It's a RAC property. It's not a parking authority property.
Yeah. Yeah, that was the other question, because it was a parking authority garage at first, and I think they sold it.
Are you talking about the garage that's behind the cinema?
Yes.
Not in front of it, behind it. Yeah. It's my understanding that they lease those spaces.
Find out.
Yeah, okay. I think we need to find out. The other question, you know, the other one that also comes up over the years is that the Chiarelli garage is very underused, which is close. But these are things that we need to take a look at, so that Alvernia is not, you know, like spread out all over the place.
Right.
For one thing, if we can get them centered in one place. But I think it would be nice to have, you know, one garage for institutional, one garage for institutional use if possible. The other things I'll discuss later about that, and there's one other thing. And actually, David went over that, so I am done.
Okay. Bob, do you have any questions for?
I don't have anything additional now.
Okay, thank you. Will?
Yes, thank you. I'm very favorable to the project. I do have a few questions. I think the recommendations from the zoner are very prudent. Balancing, not going with the variance, but requiring the review. That makes sense to me. We just do variances as if we basically repealed our zoning. The requirement about the commercial units on the first floor, I agree. I think it needs to be specific enough. It's in keeping, as he said, with our comprehensive plan, or at least the draft of it. And the reason I believe it has to be specific is we have a number of properties downtown that are commercial as a whole, but don't necessarily have the separate retail that are leased out, I guess, to other entities. And so in some cases we have just walls, quite frankly. Sometimes there's fenestration and sometimes not. And it breaks up the whole streetscape, the whole flow. you know, I would just say, in contrast to, say, like, all the window shopping that people could do on Penn Avenue and West Reading, it's more chopped up on the Penn Street corridor. Unlike, say, like, on North Fifth Street, or even some parts of South Fifth Street, or even parts of Ninth. So I think that definitely is prudent to be specific about that. On the parking...
So are we suggesting that we would have to have retail on the first floor?
I'm suggesting, and I agree with the zoning administrator's suggestion, that it be specific to encourage, I remember what the language here is, how it was put.
Not have residential on the first floor.
Not to have residential on the first floor. To have something available for some other use, commercial use. And that's what it was, by the way, before, when it was the insurance company. There were restaurants on the first floor, where people recall. And I think it was built for that.
But you're not planning on having units.
No, but I'm also not planning on having restaurants on the first floor.
Yeah, but you're...
So, I mean, if that's a requirement that...
No, I'm not being that specific.
Just not residential.
Yeah, we don't...
But the first floor will be academic. There will be a restaurant component to it, because, you know, if we went back to the slides, the corner of 4th and Penn is where we plan to have food service for students, and since it'll be a retail chain, it'll also be open to the public. I wouldn't be able to handle a design that required the whole first floor to be third-party retail, because I need that for academic space.
Right.
Okay. And it wasn't that way with CNN either.
What's that?
It wasn't that way with CNN.
No, it clearly isn't, because I can tell you CNN. The infrastructure CNN. That's yeah. there. And yeah. so they did have a food service location, but that first floor was largely their lobby, so and office space. So.
Yeah. Roberto, for instance, the fourth on the first floor on the 4th Street elevation, they had some retail offices in there when the building was initially built in 79 opened. What was before CNN? They changed the name so many times. American Casualty Company, and then it was And anyway, when they initially built that building on 4th Street, that was supposed to be, it was retail insurance offices, walk-in insurance offices. And then they didn't have that much use for it, so then they bricked it shut after it, and they used it for regular offices. But there was glass there. There was fenestration there. And there were doors from more than one source, more than one place on 4th Street elevation.
Again, our intent for the first floor is for it, as you can see, for the design to be open glass. So, and it would be looking in at the business incubator and the business labs and the communication labs, which is some neat activity if you're sort of hopping around Hen Street. But I wouldn't be able to manage a design that required it to have third-party retail. That's the reason I'm asking. I mean, the requirement is whatever you make.
I didn't mean to be that specific, but I appreciate the question, but I mean, I'm agreeing with what the administrator said in his presentation, that we want to provide for that, and that's a general policy. I mean, every time, I remember going back years, and we could look at all the other projects going back 40 years, they all have the same thing. They all have the retail on the first floor. It's always part of the allure of the projects, is that they aren't going to be just the office. They'll have something else included with them, both for their staff and for the community. So I'm just supporting that. So I think that's important to have that language in there. I certainly would not dictate the specifics of it. That's not the commission's job. We're just looking at the general principle. On the parking, I'm just wondering if it'd be acceptable in lieu of a shuttle service, if there was some other mode, for example, if it would be providing vouchers to students for public transportation. I mean, in addition, we want to, as it's in the comprehensive plan, to encourage walking and bike riding as well, at least all or part of the way. I want to make that clear, of course. Concerned about that, because there's certain restrictions on bicycle riding on Penn Square. So keep that in mind, how that might affect that. I don't know if that's a zoning or if that's some other ordinance where that comes in. But could something, and if a shuttle doesn't work or we can't find a good drop-off location, like my colleague was suggesting, would some other system be adequate to give a little flexibility?
It's a question for
me. Yes.
So there is already a provision, and now this, again, falls under special exception review, but where that allows the zoning hearing board to reduce the total number of parking spaces that are required, and the factors that they can consider in making that decision as to whether to allow a reduction would include, for example, a long-term commitment to a shuttle service,
right,
and or to subsidize the use of public transit for employees. So I think that, okay, is something that is currently built in as part of the special exception review.
Okay.
That could be designed in a different way.
But, or some combination.
Put things into consideration.
Yeah, because I think about like the school district that's, or supposedly was brought up already for something like that. I don't know, I missed the very beginning, I'm sorry. Was there any discussion, I know there was a report about payment in lieu of taxes. I know Alvernia pays, unlike Albright. I brought this up before when when there was the purchasing of an entire neighborhood of single family homes, and that the university had expanded the number of buildings and the enrollment. And I know this project would be great for the city, in every way, you know, for the economy, it could be good fiscally, but I was curious if you're at liberty to discuss anything, if there's any agreement or...
We shared it with City Council, so we made a proposal that we would increase our pilot by $25,000 a year, recognizing we would be using extra city services, mm-hmm, with another building in the downtown. And so,
right,
we are also working with the DID on a contribution to the, right, DID, and students to be doing things like escorting and cleanup work to take some of the pressure off of the DID budget. In our view, that is supportive of the city, recognizing they're two different entities, but
right,
we would be doing that, and we volunteered that as part of the process. So we need to be good citizens in the downtown, and we do recognize it creates extra resource needs. So between our students helping and helping financially, we hope to be solve that issue.
I appreciate that, because the building had been on the tax roll and then it was off, or at least partly off. I'm not sure exactly how everything was settled with the charter school being there, and it's a major property downtown, so your recognition of that is much appreciated. Thank you. That's all I have.
Okay.
When the Plex was built, we had little, almost two dozen houses there.
That's
reasonable,
right? Yeah, I think it was
24. Yeah. Most of them were nice properties. And then when they were demolished, the buildingplex, now there's a few there that have agreements with the owners, I guess, until they move for the demise. They're letting them live there. That's very generous. But still, that was a big kick in the head, tax-wise.
Well, hopefully we can make up for some of that here. And again, it's why we'd like to use the downtown footprint to grow the university. It's not our design. It's not my design as president to tear homes down in the neighborhood in the 18th Ward. We see that as a very nice family neighborhood. We love that it around and supports our university. So we believe, you know, short of not being able to come up with a solution, that the only thing we can do to grow is to eat into the neighborhood. Our design is really to focus on that.
There's a good property that's contiguous to, you know, that's been up every year, every other year, it comes up for sale again. And you buy that, and you represent more than 50% of the ownership, and you get an annex and you save your rent.
Yeah.
Because you're protected by Reading Police Department.
Mm-hmm.
The city, and you did that primarily years ago, not 18 times, to lower your insurance rates for the whole campus, because you're insured by a paid fire 24-hour 712 or 724 fire department. You get a better place on the management for the whole campus. So you're in that area for sale. It's the Cambridge Borough. You buy that, you acquire that, you get an annex, and you don't have to necessarily build it next year. You know, you hold it in advance. and we have plenty of room there, you know, where the pool is now, the
Park,
well, that's in rough repair, and that might go up for sale in there too, and that's contiguous to it. In fact, where you have a dormitory there, that was in Cambridge. We bought the property, we had it annexed already, and we leveled a block of properties and we built those dorms. So that was done before and worked out.
All right, can we get back on track with the discussion of the presentation at hand? It's up to you now to give your comment on the presentation of the zoning amendment.
I'm fine with it, I'm confident.
Okay. I just have two questions. Number one, is there a target date for the settlement of 401? I'm assuming that as we sit here today, you do not own the property?
No, we expect to settle sometime in the early summer.
Early summer, okay. Dave, this is primarily for you before I get back to John. I noticed in the write-up that came from Alvernia, there was reference to, in the last two pages, the Penn Square corridor overlay and also the institutional overlay. What's the difference between the two?
So the Penn Square corridor overlay is very limited, and it focuses on what's not wanted in the Penn Square area. It runs along Penn Street from 2nd Street to 6th, and it specifically excludes certain types of uses that include, and I should say, at the street level, daycares, all residential uses, storage, places of worship, pawn shops, surface parking, social clubs, and a few others.
Okay.
So it's kind of an odd list, you know, that is running there, but the one that, of course, would apply here is the residential uses. But again, that only applies at the ground floor, and it only applies 60 feet back.
Okay.
The institutional overlay, then, that applies in several areas, including Albright, but also other types of institutions. And it has a number of provisions that allows for colleges and university and dormitory uses in areas that would otherwise be residential, like R3, R2 even. But it allows for certain institutional type uses in those districts as an overlay.
Okay, great. I just want to say I support the project. I echo what Tammy has said. I do support our zoning and planning approach and her opinion. I do think that we do need to have that control in terms of the special exception versus by right. I support that 1,000%. Getting back to the late 60s urban renewal plan of tear it down and build new and then have all retail on the first floor, I would agree with you, John. I just don't think you want Restaurant Row there. And I think with education, what's going on today, the walk by and see what's going on is going to be a lot more exciting and a lot more visual than just another sandy salads there. So I think that's right. The retail did not work on that corner all the way around. It wrapped around. It was tough to be leased. Sandy Salads was the only one that made it for any great length of time. So I think that visual activity at the street level makes a heck of a lot of sense. The only other suggestion I would have personally is that I don't know where it stands today, Tammy. Maybe you can advise us later. But a critical part of that block is at the other end of 5th and Penn. And I have not heard, I have not read, I have not been privy to any of what's going on. I don't know who the developers were or are that submitted, but there is just a tremendous synergy waiting to happen with that property adjacent to yours.
So, yeah, we're, as you might imagine, very hopeful that as it comes out of the RFP process, that it really will create a synergy on that whole block.
Yep.
And it's a real opportunity for our students to utilize, you know, what ultimately develops.
You have one of the links eliminated on your plan. Is that your plan, or is that
It is not. It's a
visionary.
It's a visionary thing.
It's just coming down by itself.
Yeah, from another developer that's not even engaged with the three development teams that we have looking at the building, but they were nice enough to let us steal the rendering because it was the block. So not our design, and obviously we have no input to what happens with the Calo Hill properties.
All right, are there any other comments from any of commission members or members of staff?
I can tell you that the RFP for the Penn Street buildings is top priority, especially now that we have a new MD.
Okay.
I'll be meeting with him next week, and that will be on the top of our list.
Okay. That's great. Good. What is it you're looking for from us this evening, sir?
Are we looking for motions to move forward or table, or what is the procedure here?
I think, in my opinion, it would be best to table while staff reviews the questions that we have, especially concerning the parking authority, and trying to get that major problem solved. But then also this question about the definition of college and university, and a few other minor points that we reviewed, because I think we are all on the same page about continuing this special exception and things like that. But I think this would be the best time to review those things. And and the question about dormitory occupancy, because I would suspect that the fire code has limits on dormitory occupancy, and which we should probably, since we're taking a look at this, update if necessary into the zoning.
Yeah. As the building progresses and its occupancy determinations, as we all know about mixed use, there's going to have to be horizontal and vertical separations, just by virtue of different occupancies. I know the building. I think it certainly is going to be easily receptive to that kind of updating and upgrading, so I have no fear about that at all. Mm-hmm.
I just have a follow-up. I'm sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just have a follow-up. I didn't think I was making a controversial statement earlier and agreeing with the zoning administrator's specifics on the frontage. Am I to understand that the business incubators would not have storefronts? Is that it's they'd be visible behind the glass, but they're not open for the business of the public? Is that, I don't understand.
Yeah, so it, the business incubator will be completely open to the public.
Okay.
But you'll have to go through the main entrance to enter into the incubator to be able to participate, and people will be able to see that participation and all the visual that will go with that.
I understand.
From the street level. Because that's what will be on street level. I should make one point.
Thank you.
If we're going to table and sort of reconsider the issues, the shuttle service for us would be a critical component, because students taking classes in the majors and living in the building would likely be students who are in the majors that are in the college in the downtown. However, they will have to get back and forth for their class schedule on main campus, because their core courses or their liberal arts component will still be up on the main campus, and they will have to get back and forth for sporting events and other activities on the main campus. So just so that I'm being fair and honest about sort of the view of the project, without a consistent shuttle service, whether we have parking spots for some or not, we wouldn't be able to move forward with a project that didn't have a shuttle service associated with it, because it has to integrate with the campus, and there's no way to do that on an individual automobile basis. And many of our students who live on campus will come with a vehicle, but they'll be living in the building, and we certainly would have to get them back and forth. And public transportation is difficult because they have to meet a class schedule, and so it has to be fairly consistent service, just to make everybody aware.
Yeah. If I could tackle that, Lee, Adam and I had a discussion. That's why I was going to hold off on this until later, but this might be a good point to bring this up. The when Penn Street, and this is before my time, or Medi probably knows a lot more about this than I do.
Oh, my God.
When Penn Street was redesigned.
The second time.
You know, they made that as the, as like the center for BARTA.
Yes.
To,
mm-hmm.
And now that BARTA has their transportation center, Adama and I were kicking around the idea to talk to BARTA about, you know, what it would take for you guys to take over those spots so that you don't lose the parking in front of there and the students only have to walk a block or so. I forget how those bus things are arranged on between 4th and 5th.
Yeah, there's literally one right in front of our building.
Yeah. Adam and I were kicking around this yesterday, and I think, you know, with help of community development, if we could get BARTA in on the discussion. I know they use them, you know, sometimes, but they don't use them like they used to.
Yeah,
well, if we were in one of them or under one of them, you wouldn't use them either. They are 25 plus years old. They are no longer serviceable. They are a danger. They are falling apart. And part of the Downtown 2020 plan with Izette was to look at and relocate and get them on Penn Square completely.
Yeah, yeah.
There's one, there was one, don't mean to digress, but I think it'll give you some clue. There was one approach of taking all the buses off of the 400 or 500 blocks of Penn Street and putting them on Cherry and Court. Then BARTA said, oh no, we've done our fuel consumption studies and that's going to take up 2.5 more gallons per day or something nonsensical like that. It's just crazy. At the second reincarnation of Penn Square, I was at the dedication, and the chairman of the parking authority, the executive director said, we pay for this, and now we're going to put a roof over the entire 400 and 500 block so that it does become the hub, the intermodal of Reading. That was public transportation's view of center of town. I would think that it would be worth your while, John, to have a session with the parking authority, the transit authority. The shuttle obviously makes sense because of scheduled issues. And now you've got all this happening, the synergy, which is a wonderful problem to have. It's solvable. Other cities have done it. With higher densities, we can do it too. So you were working on a motion to table.
Oh, yeah.
Change his mind? Okay. Well, we need to move forward. Let's give John some insight. That's what we're going to do. I'll listen to whatever we all have to say.
Okay. I'll make a motion to table the ordinance amendments until we have clarification from zoning concerning the definition of college and university and some feedback from staff concerning parking and the bus shuttle, noting that the parking and the bus shuttle problems might not go away, but at least when we come back next month, we'll have clarification on the actual zoning, the actual zoning changes.
Motion's been made. Is there a second?
Second. Was all that parenthetical part of the motion?
Oh, yeah. Just so John knows where we're heading.
For many second. Any discussion?
No, I can't.
I just want to add that this is the first step of many. Many steps have already been taken. We don't have all the answers tonight. We've probably identified more challenges than we have solved. At least we're headed in the right direction. So if there's no more discussion, I'll have a vote on the motion. All those in favor, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you very much. John, thank you for your time.
You're welcome. Thank you.
I might add that you can consider bus stops on three sides of the river, depending on the vehicle you have. You don't have one vehicle to serve all needs. You might have school bus stops, you might have a bigger bus stops, you might have bag parking on Court Street, and 4th Street, and 10th Street, variety of things.
Would it be beneficial for staff then to work up at least a draft version of ordinance text to bring for review?
Yes.
Yes.
That would be great.
Request on behalf of the Planning Commission, as these conversations are starting to happen within the city of different bureaus, I think the more we know about what's been discussed and what's been looked at as being positive, that we know that ahead of time. Knowing that meetings are happening is great, but I personally would like to know an outcome and a position or an opinion so that we don't catch hell from the administration. Well, we never talked about that, or that's not what we're doing. Because this is a golden opportunity, as you said, to do something in the right way, and let's keep at it. Okay, thank you. Item number three, subdivisions and land development. We have Carpenter Technology land development waiver request.
Is there a way I can plug in my computer?
Next day,
I think you have to turn on this bank.
HDMI?
Sure.
Excellent.
So this is the west one.
Yeah, maybe we can.
We can turn the lights off because of the glare. Or dim them. Wayne, you saw the article about Klein Bus Service using the BARTA, whatever those are called.
Oh, no, I didn't.
Yeah, I was just telling you, Tim.
Oh, okay.
They're using one of those things for regular, regular scheduled passenger service.
Yeah.
Because we don't have the intermodal. The intercity bus terminal anymore.
Oh, right.
So they're using it, so BARTA must not be using everything all
right.
the time.
Yeah, so, yeah, I think, we get some sort of agreement. That way we don't have to, they don't have to build any other infrastructure either.
And do you see the ruts? When there's water right now, it just stays in there for so long. You know, and, because of the heavy buses, the street has never been resurfaced. It's just more and more there are ruts there, and there are pools of water, which are the mosquitoes always point out.
I forget, do we have to download something to project?
No. You shouldn't.
No, we should go straight in.
Is there any update on Hope Rescue Mission?
I haven't heard of anything since 2 weeks ago? When did we get last time?
Yeah, I think. Because they just need a final plan now, because we gave them preliminary plan.
Yeah,
so.
I think that's it.
Okay, great. Yeah.
Everything else I think is taken care of.
Because they basically submitted all their stormwater stuff.
Oh, yeah, stormwater is approved.
Yeah.
They had to tweak their plan to show some grading because of all the various...
Yeah, I guess that...
Oh, right.
But it won't change any of the stormwater. It's more or less the building itself.
Yeah.
Like, what's your first application?
Right. Yeah.
And it wasn't really well shown.
Yeah.
But they told us it will not affect the way it's graded. They know what the first floor is.
Yeah.
So it'll just be a minor tweak to the way they show it on the plan, the building elevation.
Yeah.
We should be seeing this.
Yeah, that would be great. Just get that.
Yeah.
That would be great. Yeah. They did all the heavy lifting.
Yeah.
Great.
Start building.
Was rendering, somebody put this together.
Yeah.
Is they still in the picture? We know for a fact. There's three teams out there working. If we can't get this cranked up, can we go back to the old-fashioned way?
Well, we're putting it on a flash drive so we can...
Okay.
That seems like the best way.
You weren't downtown, Bob, right?
We used to.
Paris, you left?
We were in the Madison.
Yeah.
Oh, not there. We've been out of there for 7 years.
Where would you go to lunch?
There's a, whatever was around, but our favorite was that little pizza joint in the corner up behind the post office.
Yes, there's a
problem. Well, we used to go to Washington or something. We used to go to the...
Because there was plenty of places. Because the thing, I know it's true, but there's been a flux downtown, and there were more offices that came in with the banks putting, you know, so... I don't know.
So you moved to Entech this time? They're out of the American building.
She's saying she's seen it twice.
They were in the American house.
They were in the American house.
Yeah.
Down to the gateway now?
Oh, I don't know.
And it's every Tuesday, not Wednesday, right?
Where are you now?
We're on Paper Mill. We're in the Berkshire Suites, the suite behind the Home Depot.
Okay. Oh, yeah, okay.
And you also have to go to the intermodal.
Where did you park when you were downtown?
We had a limited number of Madison parking spots. And once we maxed out, we rented over at the Abraham.
Because they had a small line. Oh, and then that day, I'm over there. Well, it's not far as the mirror, but of course.
It's right across the street.
Yeah. Washington Street's right there.
Yeah. That's right. With Madison Avenue.
Because there's a garage. We can look down right at the garage.
Yeah.
Where?
Good.
Not many, but it was still mine.
Look at the apartment. It's amazing when you see it from the sky. The size of that, you know. I call it the head out there, the insurance building. It's a huge building.
It is.
Where they come. I have more like it where they come.
Yeah.
It's working in that building.
That's what I mean, it was. It was. And then we had a similar thing with the exit, they had a garage right there.
Just watching the kids with that charter school.
Yeah.
How the buses, they would only let like three in at a time. And then they just, they would keep it flowing.
Is that right?
Hurry. Wow.
They work something out.
They have bathrooms, it's warm in there. Taxpayers paid $500 for it. What the hell? It's not sure they have this thing at all to go to New York.
You have any USB?
Yeah. Want to shift USB ports?
It's not even like...
Why is it not showing? Yeah, X out, try it again.
Wow, it takes so much.
There you go.
But that definitely is easier to see now than, thank you. less glare.
How do you want us to just go ahead and start verbally? I mean, and meanwhile, Adam, if you could keep working on that.
Sure.
I mean, give you an idea.
Yeah, I think we should.
Yeah.
Just take the time.
Do you want to give him the pointer?
Right here.
I got it?
Yeah. Okay.
So I guess we're going to have to go back to Google Maps. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Okay. So, my name is Eric Letterman. I'm with Hargrove Life Sciences, representing Carpenter Technology Corporation for the construction of several accessory use items in association with the new mill that is currently being installed in the Reading facility. They got it. Okay, great.
Where's the root directory?
It's on the root of the directory. Carpenter Images.
Third down. From the bottom.
All the way.
All the way down.
There you go. Yeah.
So there it is. So this is the project right here. It consists of this utility building right here. There's a larger replacement settling basin for the existing one, and another smaller cooling tower right here. And as we progress through this set of images in this PDF document, I wanted to make the point that this project really has no interface with the public at all. As we scroll through here, you'll see that as we approach ground level and from different perspectives, both from the north and the south, this is a direct overhead shot of our model, our correctly scaled model that's looking from the south, right? You can see that if you can stop a little bit back, Adam, I just wanted to, make it clear this topography here is some 20 feet lower or so than the finished floor of this building right here. And Warren Street bypass is to the west behind this building. So as you keep on going down, we'll see a couple more ground views. This is at grade view, and this also gives you an idea that the large building right here provides a very effective shield from public view of the entirety of this project from the most traversed road, which is the Warren Street bypass, which is just behind that large building B-55. Another scale model view. See that again, that the top of this building is nowhere near approaching visibility from the other side where Warren Street bypass is, and where we're looking from, we would be the closest that the public would have any interface to this project would be across the river. Okay, so I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with this particular parcel. And here you can see from that must be 80 feet in the air, so you can just see where that building comes between B-55 and this is the northernmost building on that parcel here. So it just kind of peeks through right at this altitude. And again, this is just another perspective looking south. Warren Street bypass would be over here. The river is back over there. And again, you're 150 feet in the air or more from this view. And this is kind of directly over the Warren Street bypass. So you're now 80 or so feet in the air. You can see the building, but here, this is traveling south. Although you would be in a lot of trouble if you were
trying to do that. Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
It's just, I guess, an anomaly of the Google Earth app. But again, completely obscured by the public view. And then the next shot is here we're at the abutment for that the bridge over the Schuylkill. There's no appearance of this building at all, shielded by both the buildings and the topography. It's down in a valley. And again, this is looking straight between the two buildings where we were looking previously at around 80 feet, where you saw just a sliver of the corner of that building. Here it's not visible at all. And this is just flipped around, turning the other way, heading north on the Warren Street bypass to the west. So the Carpenter is seeking an exemption from Planning Commission review for several reasons. The primary one being that this construction is an accessory use to the main mill primary use, steel manufacturer. And there's already an existence right here. Adam, would be great. Right here, there's an existing very similar structure. This is built in the 1940s or 40s or 50s. It's quite old. Let's put it that way. And with the new purity demands for the mill and water purity demands that requires that the settling basins be quite a bit longer and have pre-settling time. So this complex here is going to replace this, older settling basin, essentially performing the same function as it has been doing for a number of decades. So, we're in a heavy manufacturing zone here. This use is completely consistent with the current zoning. It really has less than an acre of disturbance, and we're kindly requesting from the commission that it be exempted from review, so that Carpenter can go ahead and proceed with their ongoing construction efforts without any undue delay. And if you hear any concerns or questions, if I can't answer, and I have a representative from Carpenter here that could.
You had stated that the new structure is going to be replacing the old. Are there any plans in the future, once it's complete, that the old structure is going to be taken down, or are you just going to abandon it in place?
It would probably end up being abandoned in place just for the cost of demolition. We have no use for it anymore. It's the same function as settling basin for water, cooling water.
Adam, I'll look to you first.
staff input, please?
Tim and I met with Eric and the rest of the staff from Comfort Technology, was in last Thursday, and had a lengthy conversation regarding the plans. As of this point, as we covered in the meeting, since this will not require a new or a water or sewer connection, it doesn't adversely affect the surrounding area with noise, as it's, as you stated, in a heavy manufacturing zone. We're going to check with Tim to make sure that there's no significant increase or change in the effects of stormwater runoff. And since it is already on site where it's already been impacted, we have no objection to a waiver of land development review on this project, considering they're already under heavy review through DEP and EPA and every other agency out there. So that is our suggestion from staff level.
I'll also add to that that in the past, the Planning Commission looked at a few general things before we waive things. One of the things that Adam and I talked about yesterday was like, does the building exceed the height restrictions imposed by the zoning ordinance? Obviously, this does not. The one building on the west side, I forget what it does, but the big white building that's very, very tall, we did review that, but that was because that was, you know, higher than the zoning ordinance allowed, and there were some technical things there that we needed. So, you know, we checked off that one. Utilities feeding the new building are self-contained. In other words, you're not bringing in any new water lines, electric lines, any of that stuff, because you're basically replacing something that's existing. So that's checked off. Development does not require sewer modules, obviously not. Development does not require extensive stormwater management. I don't know if you might have to write a review for MS4, but it would be minimal.
We discussed that, and in fact, there's another concurrent project going on at the same time. It's not shown here. It's a substation, electrical substation, that also generates new impervious area. This generates new impervious, even though all of this is being built on top of the existing impervious. I think, Dennis, it's all pavement right now, so it's just new impervious going on top of old impervious. So the zoning ordinance, or not the zoning, but the stormwater management ordinance does address that. There's no need for rate control on this because of that, but there is water quality, stream bank protection, and groundwater. Mr. Lederman is aware of that, and I think what they're going to do is address that with the type of devices that they can use for this particular application. There's some other complications with EPA and this sort of thing, and they're aware of that. And they're willing to just deal with public works on a separate track, like we've done in some other projects, for a stormwater management report and some of the BMPs that might be effective for doing the runoff from the new impervious area. So we have no problems with that.
And the last thing is there a significant increase in employees? And obviously, there were not. So those are the five things that we normally take a look at, because as you pointed out, normally when you build something, it's self-contained. Nobody ever knows it's there. However, what we do ask is that as-built plans are submitted to the planning department, and that your comprehensive map is updated. There's a comprehensive map somewhere. God, I forget if it's Stackhouse Bensinger or who did it for you originally a few years ago.
Maybe SSN?
Yeah, it might be, yeah. Whoever did the building on Route 12 when we had to do your rezoning, it was that firm. They have a comprehensive map of your entire facility. And we ask for an update to that, and then those are the two requirements we
really
ask for.
Building footprints.
Correct. Yeah. just basically showing where the building is and labeling what it does.
Okay.
It's a very basic thing. I'm not even sure if we can find our copy after all these years.
Some exhibits that you want to review it at this moment, but it is pretty much a plot plan showing all the existing buildings, neighboring parcels. This can be part of
I think that's all what we normally ask for.
Yeah.
Just showing, you know, where the new building is in location,
yeah,
in relation to everything else.
Those
were the only two requirements we ever asked for before on a small project like this from Carpenter.
Okay.
So just to let the newer members of the commission realize what we've done for the at least 15 years I've been on board.
Can I provide you with these and see if they meet your requirements?
Yeah, I think that would be good to submit. We don't need to look at them tonight, but
right.
Send it to Adam,
yeah,
okay, and Adam and Tim and staff will take a look.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, any other comments by any of the members of the commission? Will?
I appreciate the images. Is there an image of the existing site? Is it just the parking lot?
Yeah, it's just
okay.
The parking lot.
It was said it was impervious and paved. Just for the, Mr. Chairman, for the benefit of the public to understand, we have, the commission has a rule that we require land development for 800 square feet or more. This project is for 2,000 square feet, but we do entertain waivers when it is prudent. So I'm trying to get on the record what those reasons are, being mindful of a precedence. The fact that it's an accessory building with no additional utilities is certainly one valid justification. If I just may ask, it's a pre-engineered metal building, I understand.
Precast.
Yes. Okay, it was the pre-engineering from the notes, okay. Will it have any footers, or will it be on a slab?
It'll be on a slab.
On a slab.
It'll have footage, yes. It'll need that.
Okay.
So right now, a Hargrove, we are doing a slab work, and then the pre-engineer building folks will put the building on top of that.
But there's minimal excavation, in other words.
Correct.
Okay.
That's correct.
That's another factor. So I understand its purpose for the water, the electric, but it's not going to be a building where there are staff regularly in there,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
It's an unoccupied.
Unoccupied during the normal course, they would have access to,
yes,
it.
For maintenance.
So it really is more of an outbuilding, like you, yeah, say, accessory. And not one for.
Yeah. We did do a building's code summary, which we talked about at the one stop meeting. I did use the utility building, I don't think, one of the architects working in Hargrove. So we went through all those requirements for utility building, square footages,
right,
all that kind of stuff. So it meets all that. You see the code review and the drawings as well.
Yeah, because I don't think like we have a specific exemption for outbuildings, but by precedent, it makes sense in this case, and that's just what I'm looking for, to justify why we would give a waiver, so we don't give away our ability to do review in other circumstances where it may be prudent. So I think that satisfies me.
Okay, good, thank you. Anybody else have any comments from the commission? Hearing none, looking at the recommendation by staff, which includes both Adam and Public Works with Tim, I will entertain a motion to waive the land development requirements, or honor the land development waiver request from Carpenter Technology for this project.
I'll make a motion that the Planning Commission waives the accepts the land development waiver request from Carpenter Technology, provided that they submit as-built plans to the planning office, and an update to their comprehensive map that is amenable to the staff.
Second
by Will. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Opposed. Motion carries. Gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you.
Good night.
Next item for subdivision and land development discussion is 1722 North 10th Street, the petition to vacate Moss Street for Ronald Mercedes. Is there anyone representing Mr. Mercedes here this evening? Seeing no Mercedes in the audience.
Oh, they were not attending.
No, he's not from the case.
We can have the rights.
Shall we go?
Yes.
Adam, do you have that?
Chair, yes, they are not in attendance. This is just a procedural presentation. We'll go over, let's see if I can pull this up here.
Oh, I like the mood lighting. All right, leave it on.
So this is a motion to vacate a portion of Moss Street, and now that we're back here, for those new members of the board who have not had the honor of sitting through one of these meetings, we will give you a brief, okay, I gotta get my bearings here. There we go.
There we go. There it is.
So this property here, as you can see on your map, it's highlighted on the staff report, but basically it follows this area here. It's the property of Mr. Ronald Mercedes, who is currently using the properties at Truck Park for drivers to come into town, drop their trucks, pick up their vehicles, and go home. He's in the process of turning this into a legal use, and one of the issues that we ran into is the area along the western side of the property along Cookstown Road has a easement for a street, Moss Street, which continues on up here. So it is basically this area right here that would need to be vacated so that he can then continue with his project to make it a conforming legal zoning use. So what we're asking for, what the attorneys have submitted, is a copy of the petition and a copy of the ordinance. I have talked with our legal department, and they have accepted the petition and the proposed ordinance on the with the caveat that obviously the date be changed from June 2019 to a current date, and that Linda turned it, our city solicitor turned it into a viable ordinance in the format that the city council would prefer. Given that we have dealt with this property for the last year, and in review and consultation with Public Works, planning wholeheartedly supports the vacation of Moss Street, this portion, so that Mr. Mercedes can get on with the plan to make it a correct use and profit.
Okay, great. Tim, do you have anything to add from Public Works?
Well, I summed it up in the just to add to it. We talked about this before, but Mercedes actually owns this property where the paper street, Moss Street, exists.
Okay.
Moss Street has already been vacated to the north, so
okay,
across the railroad, up into Rawa, that property, the Water Authority property, and everything north.
Okay.
So this is just a little piece that's still left, and it hasn't been vacated because there was no real reason to do that. Now we have a reason.
The part south of that, where the people park perpendicular next to the restaurant, is that already vacated?
No.
Or is that never actually part of Moy's?
No, it's not vacated. It's still there.
That's still there. We're not covering that because everybody's moving and it doesn't affect.
That's a different property.
If the restaurant wants to do something, okay,
just
we'll deal with it at that time.
No, just curious.
We're just dealing with the property that overlays the Mercedes property.
No, that's good. Now that allows people to continue to park that way there, so that's good.
Yes, plus we have utilities in it too.
Oh.
That's going to take another.
All right, you've heard the recommendation of staff. Any comments from members of the commission? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to grant the petition to vacate the portion of Wall Street owned by Mr. Mercedes.
I'll make the motion, Mr. Chairman.
Motion is made by Armetti. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Second by Wayne. Any discussion?
Will this conclude this
once...
Approval application?
No.
No, they have submitted new plans, so once it's been vacated, then you can review the plans and then give them final approval.
There are two old guys now at this end of the table now.
Speak for yourself.
In a lifetime.
And it's still being operated?
Still being operated.
Yeah, I know, I saw it as of a few days ago.
I can see on my tombstone, we should have approved them.
Yeah, my wife says, should have, would have, could have.
All right, any other discussion for the good of the order on this motion?
We just want to remember the two requests that were put onto it, which was, if you can remind me what the two were, there was, it needs to be worded the way that the city wants it to be worded, and there was, and change the date.
Yes.
Okay, good. All right, all those in favor of the motion, please indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries. That is all of the subdivision and land development work we need. We have commission liaison report, Wayne.
Let's see here. As I mentioned, Adam and I met yesterday to discuss a few things. The number one thing that we discussed was the development at 4th and Elm, the natural something or other. It used to be the old city garage.
Supernatural?
So, yeah, supernatural produce. There we go.
I think there are other ones called.
Is it the other ones called?
I don't know if this one's the same name or not.
Okay. Yeah. Same developer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it is the same name.
Yeah. I think it is.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is a good time to bring this up then. I passed by there the other day. Demolition looks to be finished, and it looks like they've begun reconstructing the roof to the former garage. And there were plumbers there the other day. I have a suspicion that they are going ahead with construction without submitting their land development plans. They need a land development plan telling us what they're doing with the empty hole that's left over from the school they demolished. And there's also supposed to be a parking plan that goes along with this that needs review.
Well, how could they have pulled a building permit without proof of land development or zoning?
They might not have the building permit. They might only have the demolition permit, and they're trying to sneak it through. See, that's the weird thing, and we discussed this before with Albright, that they demolished the old, what's David Cross building? What is that
David
thing
Crystal?
On 13th Street?
David Crystal.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, because you can pull a demolition permit without having land development.
But isn't demolition qualified on
I don't know if there is a demolition permit. Well, there isn't through Public Works. We don't have one.
Uh-huh. See, the school's already gone. So supposedly that it was my understanding they pulled the demolition permit because I talked to Community First Fund about this. And it was their understanding that the correct demolition permit was pulled.
It would have to go through.
Well, then what do we do about it?
Yeah, it would have to go through building
insurance. If they need one.
I'll find out tomorrow morning.
All right.
Yeah, if we could
check with building insurance.
Who has the authority in the city to issue a stop work order?
Trades.
Mm-hmm. Is this the same developer and the supernatural produce at 12th and Pine?
That is correct.
That the former Brass Lantern restaurant site, where there also had to be a cease and desist order?
Correct.
Yes, thank you.
Just same to get company.
Just to get that on the record.
All right. Okay, thank you for letting us know that.
Yeah, I had already brought that up when this first came up.
So it's a very important project for the city, and it just makes sense that they do it right.
Absolutely.
But
do it right and do it legal.
And do it legal.
Safe.
Which,
safe.
You know.
What do we do? What is our position, and what are you recommending, Wayne, that we as the planning commission do? Because I think we should take action. I think we should recommend to the city.
Yeah, we should recommend to the city that if the permits are not in place, proper permits are not in place, that they have a cease and desist order until their land development plan is submitted.
Absolutely, yes.
The mayor declares a cease and desist, which did spend a dollar, and then he takes care of his people and employees and in half an hour to shut it down.
Yeah, because I remember when they shut down their facility at 12th and Pike, Andrew went with the building inspectors and shut it down. So,
let's set the precedent now that this is not tolerated, and we will not tolerate it, and we'll use the action available to us by the legal department to cease and desist projects that don't meet the requirements.
Yes.
This is bullshit. I'm sorry. What other things did you find in your trip around town?
Yeah. So. Next time, please come get me and take me with you.
It's the benefit of being able to drive around all the time with my kids and my mother-in-law and all that stuff. Oh, which does remind me, talking about my mother-in-law.
Oh, great.
The Barley Square is under construction.
Yes.
And it's going up fast because it's all prefab.
Whatever they're going to call it.
With the exception of the stair towers.
Right, yeah, the stair tower. I wanted to ask you about that because, you know, the original submission, the first floor was supposed to be masonry. And I couldn't remember when they rotated the building is if the first floor still needed to be masonry, because that first floor is prefab wood.
He told us that. He was fantastic.
Yeah, right. Okay, good. Or Matty remembers. I guess because it's only three or four stories four. Instead of five.
Yeah, it's four.
Well, depending on the type of construction and occupancy, that would tell us what all four floors can be made out of.
Yeah. So, but
okay,
that is under construction, and it's moving quickly.
Is there a sign indicating what the name of it will be?
Not that I remember.
Is it C1 on second?
Because we had a question about they were going to change. They said they were considering changing the name because it's not going to be the original vision of Barley Square.
Exactly. It was supposed to be named after the street.
Oh. We had not heard that.
But I thought, I was told, because I was waiting for that, because I need that.
Yes.
Because I'm funding it. And then I was told they changed their mind and it's going to stay Barley.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But it was like supposed to be Chestnut Square or something like that.
Yeah.
That's what they said at the meeting, and then they changed it.
Okay.
It doesn't face Chestnut anymore.
Well, right. Whatever. Oh, yeah, they turned it.
They flipped it.
Right.
So what did they, what does it change, what does it face, Grape or something like that?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, they're not going to name it Grape Square. I don't even want to make that label.
Just don't call it Supernatural Square.
Little Grape?
Yeah.
Oh my word.
Isn't that
a reason?
It was a sign.
Yeah. Bar to drop-offs.
Big Grape.
Oh. Little Grape.
Yes. Get late, guys.
Yeah. Another thing that Adam and I discussed was bus and trolley service through town to Drexel, wherever that's going to be. I forget where that's going to be. And that reminded me that I think I'm going to need Lee's help on this. Wasn't John Scott's group considering running a trolley service from 11th and Penn all the way down Penn Street through Penn Avenue all the way to Wyomissing?
Back in the day, there was a study that they funded to look at the possibility and the feasibility of trolley service on the, quote, Penn Corridor. And the trolley service study came back and said, yes, there's ridership. Yes, you can do it. You can put in track, and this is what it's going to cost. And that's where it died.
So there is some sort of thing that was looked at there. Now,
You mean there's a recent study, that study's being rejuvenated?
It's just something that Adams and I discussed yesterday, because we got Alvernia, we got this thing with Drexel coming in, and it's just an idea. And I said to him, you know, somebody funded a study for this.
Yes, I have a copy of it. Separate study. And there was an article in last week's New York Times that is proving out that revitalized downtown's trolleys do not work.
This is for the Drexel University Medical School in West Reading, with Reading Hospital, just so everybody understands.
So it was just something that...
And not necessarily a tracked trolley.
Yeah, literal.
One of those buses trolley. That looks like, you know, like they have the shore.
I was going to ask that, but yeah. Could it literally a trolley, or could it be buses that look like trolleys?
It could be buses that look like trolleys.
Well, the actual trolley overhead, high voltage lines are absolutely a thing of the past.
Yeah.
According to transportation experts.
Right.
Well, unless they're already in place and working in certain like major metropolitan areas, but not new ones, I guess.
Well, before they repaved the intersection at 2nd and Penn Street Bridge, you can see the remnants of the old trolley track, because they didn't pull them out. Oh. It's all been paved over now. So some track is there.
So
well, somebody would have to show me some real demographics that support that. That's a real pipe dream, going to Drexel from 5th and Penn. We'll see what it says. Just don't get it.
Yeah, and like I said, we weren't necessarily thinking of a tracked trolley, but of some sort of shuttle bus service, like Alvernia is thinking about running between their campus and downtown.
What they're probably talking about is a 15-passenger shuttle service, because they have a fleet of 15-passenger or 21-passenger buses now. That's what they're talking about.
Yeah, Kutztown does that.
Yeah.
They shuttle their students every, I think, hour.
Westchester does 15 minutes.
It might be sooner than that, but they're always the housing everywhere.
Yeah, right.
The grocery store.
The Reading Hospital shuttles the nursing school students.
Yeah.
The school is in the city.
Yeah.
Over there on the Museum Road.
Mm-hmm.
And shuttles them. I'm not sure. They have their own in-house shuttle. And they shuttle them, I think, to the inn at Reading, I believe.
They shuttle the employees too.
Yep. They also have a shuttle for employees. Yep.
Fleet of 10 or 12.
Yeah, they have several. Yep. And they're regular.
Yeah.
Pretty regular. Yeah.
Wayne, do you have anything more under?
Last thing is that I was able to meet the new managing director yesterday. He knocked on Adam's door, and it just turns out that I was there. Great introduction. It was, you know, very, very nice to meet him, and he gave us a little bit of background and, you know, wished us the best. So I don't think I've known of any other managing director who went door to door to, you know, meet everyone. So I was very impressed, and I look forward to working with him on future projects, because there's a lot going on.
Okay, Blighted Property Review Committee report, I have none. The next Blighted Property Review Committee is in March. Anything under other business?
Other business, our nemesis intersection, Reverend Penn had more accidents. And I found something here from our editor of our comprehensive city plan. You didn't know we had one, did we? Of was revised in 2014 from the Urban Research and Development Corporation. And there was a notation I found concerning that intersection. Quote, over the last year, the most crash-prone intersection in the city was at 3rd and Penn Streets. However, there does not appear appear to be anything that could be easily corrected at this intersection to reduce the problem. Sometimes, this is very observing, sometimes the most crash-prone intersections are simply the results of high traffic volumes. There is a solution to that, simple, that's used all over the world in traffic. Why we're agreeing with this guy's summation that there's nothing you can do about it. There is something. Several things you can do about it. But I get paid for these.
Oh, so you're going to keep us in suspense until we put out money, right?
You got it.
All right, okay. Well, we're in suspense till next month. You're not going to tell us now.
No.
All right. Anything else for the good of the order this evening, ladies and gentlemen?
I do have a couple of updates for you. We do have a blighted property coming forward for a certification. I'll be getting the information from Linda soon, so we'll put that out in front of you. Also, we have 912-914. I guess we're now calling it 914.
914.
Lancaster Avenue will be back next month. We also have one or two conditional uses coming up as well. I have also had a conversation with the managing director and the administrative director, and here in the near future, we will have both the managing director and the mayor in to discuss their vision for the city and to give us some input and direction on what they'd like to see.
Great. Good deal. Good deal. Wonderful.
Good.
Thank you. I just want to thank you, Adam, for the good graphics we now have, for what's on the agenda. You've given us the summary report, it's there. The photographs site-wise are there. It's a hell of an asset for us to figure out what we're doing. So thank you. Keep up the good work. We appreciate it. All right, if there's nothing more to come before the Planning Commission this evening, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I move to adjourn.
Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
We are out of order.
Can you do something?
Yes. Things to sign, Adam?
Second? No.
No?
Oh, fine.
She says yes.
Yeah.
It depends on what comes in.
Each side. You guys
have to do it. You know what compliance would be.
Okay.
All right. Well, no wonder you're sitting here, Rosie. You got a
furry purse.
Furry.